Nicolas Vedrian.
It's not going to be a commercial presentation. It's going to be a training on payment for marketplaces. No need to take pictures or to take notes because we have plenty of those, which is a full pack of knowledge that we did together with Ed Garden and Company, a very famous consulting company when it comes to payment. Before we start, I'd like to know who is in the marketplace business, who is putting in contact some many sellers with many buyers in the audience. Anybody? One, two, okay. Who is going to be a marketplace in the future, even if you have a traditional business today? You're not sure. Oh, one, there is one, okay. Well, that's very important because according to our research, 1/3 of the volume of e-commerce will be done through marketplace by 2020. Currently, it's a little bit less than 15%, but indeed inside you have Amazon, but in the next 3 years, this will go to 40%. So we'll first do an introduction to see why is that happening, why do people want to buy more and more in marketplaces. First, the consumer wants choice. Whenever it's a marketplace, they think they have access to several buyers and they can choose themselves. They don't want anymore to be pushed any product, and marketplace is a solution for that. As a seller, also, accessing a marketplace means accessing the world. So if you are even a small company today, you can access people in Siberia, in Colombia, in Patagonia, staying in France, but through the marketplace, you have access to the world. And finally, as a business owner, a marketplace is much less risky than a traditional business because you don't have to take the responsibility for the stock of the services, for example, and we'll see that for the payment also it's much less risky. The types of marketplace you have currently are generalist pure player, vertical pure players. There is a new trend where traditional players who are not marketplaces, even the brick and mortars, are opening part of the services to the marketplace. So I give you an example. If, for example, you take a big supermarket chains in the US, some of them will advertise in their website some products that they don't sell directly. It will be Unilever selling it directly through the website of Walmart, for example. Walmart was one of the first ones to do that. And finally, you have all this boom of sharing economy, collaborative economy, that is pushing the marketplace up in the market. Now, when it comes to payment, there are three types of marketplace. And this is a very important point. It's because of a new regulation entering next month for payments. It's called the Payment System Directive 2, and that applies to any marketplace in Europe. If you set up a marketplace, you will have three choices. First choice is to be a financial institution. This means being a bank. Even if you're selling some travel product or services, you will have to register as a bank. Now, this takes 2 million and 2 years. We did that 10 years ago. I'm not recommending you this route because it's extremely painful and you become regulated as a bank. It's one of the only real financial institutions that is a marketplace in the world is Amazon. Amazon is also a financial institution. The second option applies if you have very few sellers. So let's say you're reselling product from 10 companies. The sellers are 10 companies, therefore you can ask them to register with Visa, MasterCard, etc. to be what we call a merchant of record. As a merchant of record, if all your sellers are merchant of record, you don't need to be a financial institution. But again, it applies if you have very few sellers. It will not apply to an Airbnb, for example. So most of you will be on the third case. You will just be a broker, a commercial agent between many sellers and many buyers. What's new in that figure is that you cannot touch the money anymore. So far, you could intermediate the money, except in France and Germany, where you already had a regulation in place. Going forward, for all Europe, for all volume over 1 million euro, you cannot anymore accept the payment directly and then pay it to the sellers. So we'll see what's the impact for the consumer experience and how to proceed. The six pain points you will have are first, the seller onboarding. Second, the regulation, as I just said. The payment acceptance, the payout, what we call the split payment. And then you will see there is many potential fraud in this system as well. When we speak about the seller onboarding, it is mandatory to do what we call a KYC exercise. You must identify properly the sellers on your marketplace, and you have to keep the record that you identified those sellers. There are some regulations that forbid you to have some type of sellers. I mean, you cannot have Bin Laden selling some product on your marketplace because this is forbidden by law and you're liable for it. So it means that you have to check a lot of external database as well to see if you can accept this seller. Now, commercially, how to increase this aspect? When you have a seller going to your marketplace, he wants to sell now. So you cannot wait 2 weeks asking him for telephone bill or proof of ID. It has to be very fast. So most of the system allow an online upload of some documents. The number of documents and checks you have to do depends on the volume that the buyer will do. If this buyer is seller is becoming very big for you, you will have to re-KYC and ask for more, let's say, accounts or proof of ID. What you can do is that you can ask to upload, and you have some services like ours that are checking that very, very quickly. So in 3-4 minutes, the seller can already start selling. Most of the marketplace are already like this. In fact, you're not completely checked, but you're doing your page and putting for sale, you know, your flat or things like that. But in the meantime, in the background, they are checking you. Okay, so that's the number one. Number two is this legal point that you have as from next month. So let's look a little bit at the money flow and see if my laser is working. Yes. So you will put in relationship some buyers through your marketplace with some sellers. When the buyer is interested into a product, he will have to pay. The money will have to go to a bank, like SafeCharge, for example, in an escrow account. The money cannot go in your company. This amount will be kept in the escrow. You will deliver the goods, and when the goods are confirmed to be sent to the buyer, then you will give instruction to your external financial institution supporting you to release the money. But you want to keep part of the money as a commission. So in that case, the financial institution will give you your commission that you define, and then will send the money. It's getting more complex when a buyer bought several products from several sellers. Then in that case, there was one single payment here. You will keep the commission, but then your bank must split in three, let's say, the payments to give to each seller. That's the complexity of the system and the payment flow. The only thing to remind is that you cannot do this exercise yourself. You have to go to a bank and keep that into an identified escrow by seller, but knowing already, by buyers, knowing already to which seller is going to be split. Splitting commissions is not easy because if you think about it, the seller may be located in China, so he will have paid at a certain currency rate, but your buyer will manage another currency. So in the middle, you have a time where you hold the money and you're about to do the split payments. And you know, the variation of currency makes this exercise very complex, because the amount you're going to pay to the seller may be different than the one from the client, the consumer who went to. So that's also something very complex to keep in track. Okay, customer friendly experience. Same. If you're going to launch a marketplace, people from all over the world will access the marketplace. The types of payments the buyers will want to use may be different than the type of payments the seller will want to receive the money. Different countries, different practices. Here, for example, in Germany, people like to pay by invoice. In the Netherlands, they love to pay with iDeals. So these are only two examples, but my clicker is not working. You must keep track also of these different type of payment methods. So this is a picture of my VP Finance, actually. How do we do that? Again, you have this payment flow. 1, 2, 3 is going reverse way here. You first have somebody buying for 30 euro, let's say. It's approved, it's a sale, okay. This goes into an escrow because we know we are going to pay only 90 euro to the seller, and the marketplace is going to keep 11 euro. And then after, in your account, you will have this kind of, let's say, account. You always must be able to track this for tax reason, for compliance reason. Stay in control, because it's even more complex when you add all the split payment, etc. This is what we do internally for you. And we give you access to those accounts. This is a little bit complex, but basically you have two flows, the real funds and the virtual funds in parallel. And you have three buckets. One is the buyer, the seller, and the escrow. Okay? So when it comes to this, you must stay in control, be able to have a transparency with the accounts and all the escrows that are kept in the financial institution, and be able to access it every time. You cannot deal with a black box in case you have an audit or a tax visit or you know, something from your government. You must be able at an instant T to give the detail of what I showed you. When it comes to payment types between the seller and the buyer, this is an example just for Thailand. We do process, for example, 160 different types of payments. This is only for Thailand. And you see that for some payment method, let's say true money, you can only pay with true money as a consumer, but you will never be able to pay a seller with true money. You will have to choose another type to do the cash out. For example, TMB in Thailand, we know that sellers like to receive money with TMB. So country by country, you will have to deal with those specifics and review very well what type of payment method you want to offer. To give you an example, the checkout page, which is your page where the buyers are going to come, are responsible for 12% of the abandon when buying some goods. If you don't have the payment method that the consumer is expecting, there can be a drop-off rate of 12%. What does it mean? Well, your turnover of all the company will drop 12% if this payment page is not adapted to the consumers you're targeting. Same for the sellers. They will want to be paid very quickly when they want, especially on their first experience and by the type of payment means they require. If not, they will go to another marketplace if you have competition, because not everybody is Amazon. So you may have some marketplace competitors. So the way to win the race is to pay very fast and very accurately the sellers, and to offer to the buyers the payment method they want. There are also some other techniques, because in some countries, the payment method for the buyers you know, can be technically a little bit so-so. So if there is a decline on a payment for a consumer, what you want to do is to offer a second payment method. Like, you know, you try to pay with AstroPay, it didn't work, but are you sure you don't want to try PayPal? I'm sure you have a PayPal account. In that case, we are speaking about payout recovery. Remember those 12%? You can minimize as well by trying to recover the payments. Another example is for goods with a certain value. Some payment methods do not have a limit that is quite low. So let's say a consumer wants to pay 1,000 euro, try a credit card, it's not working. You can offer them to split the payment between two payment methods, saying, do you want to try half on your credit card and half on PayPal, for example? Again, it has an impact for you in the escrow account where you will keep the record of those payments. Stop working. So, the 5 points to take with you. First, your payment service provider must be your best friends because you're going to interact daily with this company, this payment technology company that is owing you money and holding your money. So you have to choose a reliable partner. Always comply with local payment regulation. It's really a radical change, the fact of externalizing this payment flow in Europe. And you must really comply for that because you can close directly, the government can close you the marketplace. This happened, if I'm right, a couple of years ago with a famous marketplace in Germany when they implemented this law. Support several payment methods, both for the pay-in and the payout in your marketplace. Control the split payment. Be sure that your provider can do split payment to several sellers for the same consumer because you will not be able to ask for one payment per good to your consumer. It's very important. But still, we are seeing in the market a lot of project of marketplace where the reality is that they are going to ask to the consumer one payment per good or per experience, if it's travel, for example. And finally, increase the protection against fraud. So how can you do fraud in marketplace? Well, it's very common. Few years ago, the marketplaces for the food industry, you know, those home delivery between restaurants and consumers were very targeted by that. How to commit fraud? I'm going to disclose a secret for you here. Let's say I have a pizza restaurant or guided tour restaurant, a guided tour company, and I'm going to offer the services in the marketplace. My best friend has 500 stolen credit cards, and I tell him, go and buy through the marketplace my guided tours. I will cash the money from the marketplace, but nobody is going to pay because it's a stolen card. So there are also a lot of frauds on the seller side. Fake sellers will try to register to your marketplace in order either to do some money laundering, because sometimes you can launder the money through a marketplace, or simply to get some incomes with stolen means of payment. So you need to have in place fraud detection tools that analyze the behavior both of the sellers and the buyer and to see the relationship with them. Give you an example, this example with the 500 stolen cards. If all the orders are done from the same IP, it's very likely that it's a fraud and it's all done on the same seller. So it's very likely that those guys are working together to commit fraud. You must have a system in order to detect this as well. That's all. Again, we have a much more comprehensive booklet. So as I said, we are an electronic money institution. We also have an FCA license in the UK. We are principal member of Visa, MasterCard, floated on the London Stock Exchange, PCI compliant, also GDPR compliant, you know, the new data protection law that is going to be enforced in May. We offer over 150 payment methods. We pay in 100 currency, and we have an uptime that is record, 24/7 dedicated support. And my last word today will be, if the clicker is working, that our clients love us. We have a fantastic retention. So if you're ever thinking to put a marketplace, or if you had a marketplace but not compliant with the new law, please speak to us, and we'll be happy to support you. Okay? Thank you very much.